Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, WrestleZone would like to welcome you to tonight's live event. Before we begin, please be advised that all WrestleZone stars are professionally trained, so please do not copy or imitate anything you see here tonight. Please also be aware that WrestleZone is proud to provide entertainment suitable for all ages, and we ask that you refrain from using any inappropriate language this evening.
It was a wild night this past Saturday at the Curl Sports Complex in Aberdeen for the WrestleZone Regal Rumble. I'm Billy, I'm your host for the WrestleZone podcast. We've got a wild couple minutes or so that I'm going to speak about this particular show. So we're properly on the road to Aberdeen Anarchy now. We know the date, we know the main event as well, and it looks like we've got some teasers to some possible matches that will be coming up on that night on May 11th. At Rich Energy Arena in Aberdeen. I'm absolutely buzzing. So to transparent with you, recording on Tuesday, and we're going to put this out probably the same day, maybe Wednesday as well. But so there'll be probably more things to keep an eye on social media for WrestleZone if you want to go and check out for any footage. We should have an episode of the SWM podcast coming out next week about Aberdeen Anarchy. There'll be a montage, all that kind of good stuff, and reactions literally minutes after the show as well, and before the show, and around about the show, and show. So yeah, let's just talk about the Regal Rumble then for the WrestleZone podcast. Let's just recap it. So it was a boiling venue at Curl Sports Complex. Yep, roasting. I chose shorts that day. I'm so glad I did. But we started with a VIP ticket holder match with Caleb Valhalla taking on Mayhem Brooks, who's making his debut in WrestleZone. And he made quite the impression. He made a very good impression for WrestleZone in front of the crowd, in front of a new audience for him that didn't know how to make of him at first. But the more that he beat down on Caleb Valhalla, the less people in Curl Sports Complex liked Mayhem Brooks. They were very much against Grapzilla himself from Elgin. Caleb, it was a non-title match. Caleb didn't have the pressure of defending the Tri-County Championship, but he did come out with the Regal Rumble trophy so he could present or present it back to WrestleZone after holding the trophy for a year and cashing his shot last year at Aberdeen Anarchy against Aspen. He was unsuccessful in the night, but we'll talk about that in a little bit. So yeah, Caleb and Mayhem, they just went at each other. Big kicks, big throws, big punches, big everything. Caleb was able to even throw in some of his tricks of second rope flying, wrench rope, most dangerous rope. But eventually Caleb was able to pick up the win. But it wasn't without controversy, though, because Mayhem Brooks, he didn't take too kindly to this offer of a fist bump, a handshake, some respect, as he put Caleb Valhalla into an armbar. There's probably a fancy name for it that Caleb Brooks will correct me on. But so not a lasting impression as far as endearing himself to the WrestleZone audience, but Mayhem Brooks put on a fantastic match that was well worth seeing him debut. And as someone who lives in Elgin, it was very cool to see Mayhem make an impact that way as well in WrestleZone for his debut. So on to the main show. So we kicked off with the big guns. The handicap match for the undisputed WrestleZone Championship when Flippy and Drippy, Conor Malloy and Ronan King tried to dethrone the champion Lost Boy Aspen. And I said in my preview that it could just be a case of Aspen just chopping the bejesus out of his opponents. And that did happen. There was a lot of... It started off as a one-on-tag, so one was on the outside of the ring, and a little bit of shenanigans that way with Ronan and Conor trying to keep on top as much as they possibly could. Eventually, the match did break down, and it ended with a little bit of, not even miscommunication, just bad luck in the case of Flippy and Drippy. With it ended up being, I think from memory here, Ronan had his back on the floor, his legs up because he'd just been thrown back, and then Conor was thrown on top of Ronan, and Aspen pinned both of them. But that makes it sound like it was an easy night for Lost by Aspen, possibly one of the most tensest, one of the tensest matches he's had for that title since Abenaki last year, because there was many a good chance that Flippy and Drippy were going to pick up the gold, and they never looked to sway away from wanting one to win over the other. They were both very much a team. They were trying to help each other, or at least support each other in that victory, which was a thing that I also brought up, whether Ronan and Connor would possibly have that kind of miscommunication, that disagreement on who was going to win. But no, the Flippy and Drippy really were a team on Saturday, but unfortunately they just came up short with Lost Boy Aspen and picking up the win and retaining the title once again as he marches towards the Abenaki main event for the second year in a row. But a fantastic match, absolutely fantastic. Well, I'll go into it more, I'm sure, on the SWM podcast, but as for now, as a recap, we saw the champion retain once again. Then for something a little bit different, we had the Warriors against Low Life Entities. Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins taking on Speed Metal. Mickey Vago, not Michael. That's Captain Al's name for him. Mickey Vago and Tommy Raiden in a tag team match, which the Wallies won. The Wallies actually won. But it was thanks, in no small part, to the returning Judas Grey. We last saw Judas Grey back Christmas Chaos, where he took on Mickey Vago. And thanks to Tommy Raiden, Mickey Vega was able to pick up the win on that night. So Judas came back and returned the favor, caused the distraction, which led Rhys Dawkins to allegedly hit Tommy Raiden with his Book of Shakespeare and get the victory while Mickey Vega was distracted by Judas Grey. Another, I would say, a surprising match, maybe. We got to see a little bit of Speed Metal together. We got Tommy Raiden in his new look with the skinny jean shorts and all that kind of stuff, and he's certainly getting settled in to the Speed Metal lifestyle that Mickey Vigo has introduced him to. So there was nice stuff there, and we got to see the Wallies win, which is a rarity at the moment. We haven't seen them win in a little while, and they've got this new alliance with Judas Grey. So that's three guys there. We've got Vigo and Tommy Raiden. Maybe we need to recruit someone. Maybe we need to recruit someone who can join in on their fanging, headbanging times. Maybe they can look for a new brood, so to speak, in WrestleZone for Abenaki. Who knows? That's just wild speculation on my part. But yeah, seeing Judas Grey back terrified me after Christmas Chaos, I'm perfectly honest with you. But it was a great night. A great night for the Warriors against Low Life Entities, even though they did it through nefarious means. Speaking of different, we had Captain Alan Sterling versus TV's Omar Mohammed. And the fact that Omar put out on social media that he was fasting during during this match is incredible, because he put on an absolutely stellar performance against Captain Alan Sterling. These two guys have incredible chemistry in the ring, even if it is Captain Alan just trying to get his hands on a Shivani. What transpired, though, is there was no agreement, but there was a request that if Omar was going to put on his Shivani on the line, then Captain Alan should put his battle hat on the line, which was disrespectful in the eyes of Captain Alan Sterling. So the match went ahead, and like I said, we got to see Omar bust out some fantastic maneuvers. He looked great, crisp, smooth in the ring, but 2 feet on the ropes from Captain Alan meant that Alan Sterling picked up the win, and by his own admission, he took the Shawadi Wadi away. And he left with it, because he won it in his eyes, even though there was no agreement. It wasn't like Granite City Showdown. There was no agreement that jacket was on the line. But Captain Alan took it anyway and left Omar without a jacket, and which he didn't need in the Curl Sports Complex. It was boiling. But he left without it, thanks to Captain Alan's cheating ways. But what can you say about Captain Alan? He's an enigma wrapped in a weirdness. I don't know, but he came out with the win, and kicking off the 2024, he didn't have much luck the first 2 months, but we're into March now, and now he's picked up winning ways with gaining the Shawadi Wadi. How are we going to see that progress? Are we going to see maybe some Shawadi Wadi, some clothing on a pole match, maybe a ladder match at Rich Energy Arena, or will this all be settled in Ellen? We'll find out soon. Now, this is the first half main event. Up next, tag team match with, oh, sorry, not tag team match. Apologies. Damien, I've read it as tag team match. Damien versus Ryan Riley with the Foundation at ringside for Ryan and William Starling at ringside for Damien. And I said it in other things. I'll say it in the SWM podcast when it comes out, that I put this down as a dark horse as match of the night. And it was. It was fantastic. It was a great match. Ryan Riley, when he was on, when he wasn't looking for handouts from the Foundation of the Future to help out, was incredible. Damien was on point. And then, unfortunately, the Foundation got involved. Zach Dynamite and Bruiser Brad Evans got into the ring to start the assault on Damien. William Starling came in. He got assaulted as well. Nobody came out to help. I was thinking, oh, maybe we'll get to see Mr. WrestleZone return. Maybe we'll get to see some help here. But no, as they were carried out, then this happened. This disgrace happened in WrestleZone. The Foundation of the Future intimidated MC Martin Clunas to come to the ring, to get into the ring, and to call the correct winner in their eyes. So Martin called the winner rightly. Damien defeated Ryan Riley by disqualification. They gave him another chance. Martin, thanks to the behest of the crowd, called it again. Damien defeated Ryan Riley by disqualification. And then Bruiser Brad Evans attacked Martin Clunas by hitting him in the back of the head. And the Foundation assaulted Martin Clunas until crew ran in to try and separate them as soon as possible. So we've seen the attacks on the Foundation of WrestleZone through William Starling, through Mr. WrestleZone, through Damien. And now we're seeing them attack not only wrestlers, but non-wrestlers and MCs. And they were very pushy with the crew as well. The Foundation of the Future need to be stopped. And we may have found the answer a little bit later on when we talk about the Regal Rumble. It was shocking to see Martin get attacked. It's not something, I can't remember the last time, if ever, we've seen Martin Clunas get assaulted at WrestleZone. And it left a bad taste in some people's mouth. But there's a little bit of redemption, just a tiny bit, later on. Which, let's just get into it. The Regal Rumble. Oh my god. This Regal Rumble was incredible. The 2024 edition was possibly one of the best ones I've seen. And I've seen quite a few over my years going to WrestleZone shows. We started off with Alex Webb and Air Miles as number one, number two and number one, technically. So Air Miles is number one, Alex Webb is number two. So we got a little bit about a back and forth between the Fair City Saints. I don't have the order in front of me, so I won't have, I can't go 1, 2, 3, whoever. But we got to see some interesting moments, including Zach Dynamite refusing to enter. Next entrant after that was Bruiser Brad Evans, who refused to enter. And then eventually, once Ryan Riley entered, they all came out. But not before taking out Blue Thunder. Blue Thunder was entered. He never made it to the ring, as Bruiser Brad Evans spinebustered him through a table. We got to see the return of Scotty Swift. Scotty Swift came out to try and even the odds and try and help remove the Foundation of the Future from the match, which caused a huge fracas and a huge brawl at ringside. Eventually, Mr. P stopped the match. The first time I've ever seen the Regal Rumble get stopped. It paused. The wrestlers had to just pause in the ring while this brawl was getting sorted out. The Foundation of the Future, I don't remember the, I think maybe one, I think Ryan was maybe eliminated, but I'm thinking the rest of them were disqualified. There were so many things happening in that match that you was trying to keep your eyes on everything going about. And we've got some like tag team things. Bluffy and Drippy were in the ring at the same time. So we've got the Fair City Saints as well. Mr. Malice, Lord Mr. Malice, God love him. He entered this particular match in a full body armor with a helmet as well. We got that. His chest piece was back to front. He had the chesticles on his back. And he entered the ring slowly, gingerly. And possibly one of my favorite, like, there were so many great moments, but just a little underrated favorite was Mayhem Brooks asking him what he was doing and Malice headbutting him while wearing a helmet. That was just, it was just beautiful. Unfortunately, Malice ran towards the ropes and Caleb Valhalla ducked and sent Mr. Malice out of the ring. For at least he's still alive. That was Malice's his declaration once he hit left the ring was shouting that he's still alive. And that was, it was a heartwarming moment in the sea of chaos that we saw at the Regal Rumble. Eventually came down to the final four. Mayhem Brooks, Omar Muhammad, again, still fasting. Well, I think he maybe just got something to eat at that point. I think his fasting ends at like 7, I think he put on social media. So we had Mayhem Brooks, Omar Muhammad, Captain Alan Sterling, still wearing his Shawadi Wadi, and Caleb Valhalla as your final four. And it had to be, right? It had to be. Before I do that, Captain Alan was able to send Omar Muhammad out, but Omar was able to get hold of the battle hat. So now the battle lines are drawn. We've got Omar Muhammad, TV's Omar Muhammad, holding Captain Alan's hat, and we've got Captain Alan Sterling holding Omar Muhammad's Shawadi as well. So the battle lines are drawn there. Like I say, will it be resolved? Ellen, will we wait until Aberdeen Anarchy to see some sort of article of clothing on a pole match or ladder match that we can squash this once and for all? Final two, Captain Alan Sterling, Caleb Valhalla. Now, I put out on Twitter, X, in the day afterwards, that it had to be this. It had to be this as the final two. Caleb never really got that closure with Alan Sterling from 2019, when Alan blamed Caleb for losing a tag title match. We got to see the breakup of Captain Alan and Caleb Valhalla on that night. But at the Regal Rumble, Lord Mr. Malice was able to eliminate Caleb thanks to Alan Sterling. I think Caleb was only in for minutes because he came in on a rampage. Then last year happened. Last year, we may have got the showdown between Captain Alan and Caleb Valhalla, but Deacon Matthews stepped in and eliminated Captain Alan Sterling. Then this year, the final two. Like, my pick had already went out. Ronan King went out. My throat was already dead at that point because he was my odds-on pick, Ronan King, and he ballsed it up. So that's on Ronan. And I was sitting there taking in the final four, taking in the final two. And it was final two. I was like, maybe Omar. Maybe we'll get to see Omar. But it had to be Caleb. Caleb and Alan, we finally exercised the demon of Captain Alan when Caleb Valhalla threw Captain Alan over his head out to the floor. And as soon as his feet hit the floor, the crowd erupted. We've got to see Caleb Valhalla two-time back-to-back Regal Rumble winner. The first time it's been back-to-back since Crusher Crane, a man that Caleb earned the respect of and defeated. We got to see that happen. We got to see the confrontation. Lost by Asprey came out with the title, with the undisputed title in hand. There was a little tension. It was a match I don't think Asprey particularly wanted because he struck up a friendship with Caleb Valhalla. They've learned things. He's taught him the ways of Midgard. And because of that, Asprey wanted to maybe turn up a notch, turn up a gear, because they've had the match before. They've wrestled each other for the undisputed WrestleZone Championship at Aberdeen Anarchy. So he requested that Caleb also puts the Tri-Counties Championship on the line. So we've got it. Mr. P confirmed it. Winner takes all. Aberdeen Anarchy, May 11th, 2024, an event that will be featuring Gangrel, former WWE superstar. We are seeing Lost Boy Aspen versus Caleb Valhalla, winner takes all, WrestleZone Undisputed Championship, WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship. There's going to be one winner. One's going to walk out with both titles. I think this is the first time since 2011, maybe, that we've seen I don't think it'll be unification, but with title on the line. Like last time, maybe 2020. I apologize, I don't have that initially in front of me. But it was Scotty Swift versus Damian for the No Limits Championship and the Heavyweight Championship, which became the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. So here we are. We are weeks away. Not that many weeks away. We've got a trip to Ellen in the meantime on April 20th. There's a lot to be happening. There's a lot of content we're going to try and provide for you as well. Regal Rumble, it was a fantastic, phenomenal event for WrestleZone, and I can't wait for Aberdeen Anarchy. So Ellen on April 20th, and then May 11th, Aberdeen Anarchy at Rich Energy Arena in Aberdeen. Fantastic. Anyway, this is the recap. I'll do some other gubbings and writings and things and just amazement about this event, but I'll talk about that and repeat myself ad nauseum constantly. But for now, this is a WrestleZone podcast. My name is Billy. Go enjoy some wrestling. Go and check out some WrestleZone at a show near you. Have a good one.